currency. Mr. Finance, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to deliver the 15th widest lectures and the topics from flying geese to leading dragons. And we know that when WIDER was established 25 years ago, one of its mandates is to study economic structural changes and to help the country in a poor world to reduce the poverty and to improve the living standards. But I'd like to say, in the past decades, the economic profession neglected the importance of structural changes in their research. And today I hope to use this opportunity to revive the interest in the study of structural changes. And I try to propose a new economic theoretical framework to understand the economic structure, its determination, and how it evolved, and hopefully this kind of understanding can also help us to improve our policy to promote the poverty reduction in the world. And my lecture will cover a few subjects. The first one is that why we need to rethink the current status of economic development. And then I'd like to say, economic development, in effect, is a process of structural changes, and it will follow a pattern called the flying geese. And then I'll propose the new structural economics as a way to understand that kind of development process. Follow that, I will bring in that we are in a new multipolar growth world. And in this new world, it's not going to be just a flying geese. It's going to be leading dragons. It will provide great opportunity for many countries to have the structural changes. And then I'll propose a new approach to tap into that new world. Okay. The thinking of economic development is a common thing in the last 2 years. And the main reason is because of the economic crisis that we are encountering now. But why economic crisis stimulate so many rethinking? It is because the function of economic theory is to explain the observed economic phenomenon. And not only to explain the phenomena, it also help us to formulate economic policy in order to improve the world or to improve the living standard and so on. Whenever the economic theory cannot explain the economic phenomena, or economic policy choice based on the economic theory cannot achieve its target, then we need to rethink the theory. And currently, certainly, the global financial crisis and so on cannot be explained by the existing economic theory, and so we have a lot of rethinking. Use this standard, I'd like to say, the development economics has been on the process of rethinking since it was formulated in the 1940s. At the beginning, the development economics was dominated by the group of economists called structuralists. At that time, their understanding of why some countries are so poor, their proposal was because of the market failures in the developing country, and they cannot develop the same industry as in high-income country. So they proposed to use some kind of import substitution strategy through the government intervention in order to improve their economic performance. However, countries following that approach failed miserably. And so by the time of 1980s, the understanding in economic profession changed to the so-called Washington consensus. In that consensus, the understanding for economic performance in a developing country was that the government failures were more serious than the market failure. So the best way for promoting economic growth is to liberalize the economy, to liberalize the state-owned enterprises, and allow market to function. And a country followed this approach, their results were mixed at the most. And during this period of time, certainly there were some countries, economies, are doing extremely well. From the 1950s to the 1970s, 80s, there was a group of economies in East Asia. Their growth rate achieved 8 or 9% continuously for 20 or more years. And for those economies, they adopt export promotion instead of import substitution. And it was different from the policy prescription of the development economics at that time. And in the 1980s and onward, during that Washington Consensus period, China, Vietnam, and also Mauritius, their economic performance were also extremely remarkable. And again, they did not totally liberalize their economy. They adopt some kind of dual track approach. On the one hand, continue to provide some support to their old sectors and liberalize their entry to new sectors. And they achieve, again, 8 or 9 or even higher percentage of growth rate continuously for 20 or 30 years. And in these two groups of economies, they have some kind of common characteristics. That is, they all rely on a market as the basic foundation, but they have a proactive government in the development process. And their combination of the orientation and strategies was neither the old structuralist approach or the Washington consensus type of approach, because their approach and performance were different from the theoretical explanation, so we need to rethink our current understanding of economic development. And I'd like to say, the World Bank has been on the process of rethinking of economic development since the 1990s. And one evidence is the publication of East Asia Miracles. And in that publication, the finding was for a country to have a successful economic development, the best way is to have export orientation and to have a market-friendly government. And in the 2004, the World Bank published another publication called The Lessons of the 1990s. And that was after 10 years of economic transition in Eastern European countries. And to understand the success and the failures. And the conclusion is that countries are different. And so the policy should not have a one-size-fits-all policy. And in 2008, the World Bank published another publication called the Growth Commission Report. It was a commission led by Nobel Prize winner Michael Spence, and to study 13 successful economies in the world since the Second World War. Those 13 economies, they achieved 7% and higher growth rate continuously for 25 years. And among these 13 economies, they have a common features. That is, first, they are all open economy. Secondly, they achieve macro stability. Third, they have high growth rate and high investment rate. And fourth, they are all rely on market mechanism, and they also have committed, credible, and a capable government. And as I say, economic theory, its function is to explain economic phenomena. And if we want to rethink economic development, then we need to understand what are the phenomena we wanted to explain. Well, the economic development certainly is related to how to promote fast, sustained, and inclusive growth in our country. And I'd like to say, as you know, this is a recent phenomenon. Because before the 18th century, all the countries in the world are poor. And even now, the rich country in Europe and so on, their per capita income and the per capita income in countries like Africa actually were similar, at most 50% difference. And also before the 17th century, 18th century, the rate of economic growth was about 0.05% per year. That means that it took about 1,400 years to double per capita income. But for Western European countries, after the 18th century, their rate of economic growth accelerated to about 1% per year. And that means that it took about 70 years to double the per capita income. And entering into the 19th century, 20th century, the rate of per capita income growth accelerated again and to about 2% per year. That means it took about 35 years to double per capita income. And you know, a number of countries were able to join this group of faster growth, but most other countries in the world did not, you know, follow the same path. So as a result, the income gap between the high-income country, industrialized high-income country, and low-income country widened. And this kind of acceleration in economic growth certainly is a result of industrialization and bring in continuous technological innovation. But I'd like to emphasize, that is, it's not only a technological innovation, it is also a process of structural changes. We know that, like the US, a high-income country today, their production structures are computers, robots, airplanes, and they also have financial sectors, as well as, you know, a high education research institution. Those are their economic structure now. But in 19th century, the production structure in the US was textile industries, shoemaking industry, and that was similar to, you know, many low-income developing countries today. And 300 years ago, in the 17th century, the production structure in the U.S. was agriculture, and it was similar to, you know, very low-income country today in Africa and in other parts of the world. And this is the process of economic development, structural changes. And this kind of structural changes in our country or in the global scene will follow something like flying geese pattern. Now look at the bottom. Japan, in the 1950s, its main industries was garment, and then we sit to steel, then TV, then video, then high-definition TV. And in our country, it's a step-by-step move up the industrial ladies in a pattern the Japanese scholar Akamatsu call it a flying geese. But not only in our country. When Japan moved from the garment to steel, then the garment industry in the 1960s moved to the Asian tigers like Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore. And then in the 70s, when Japan shifted to the production of TVs, they still shifted to Korea. And Korea's garment industry started to shift to the Asian country like Indonesia. And step by step, something looked like the, you know, the flying geese as I show on the right-hand panel. The big goose that the more advanced country move up the industrial ladders, then other second-tier country follow, then third-tier country follow. This is a structural changes we observed in our country and also in the developed and developing country in the modern growth period. And how come we have this kind of structural changes? I try to propose a framework to understand them. The framework I'd like to propose is the new structural economics. And why I call it a new structural economics. You know, this is because I wanted to apply the neoclassical economic approach to understand the determinants of economic structure and its evolution. In economic convention, if you apply the neoclassical approach to study agriculture, then you should call it agricultural economics. And you apply this approach to study finance, then you should call financial economics. And so, following this convention, I should call this approach as a structural economics. However, as I mentioned, in the 1940s, 1950s, at the beginning of the development economics, it was dominated by a school called the structuralist and structuralism. And to distinguish my approach from their approach, I call this new structural economics. And in effect, it's also a convention in economics. We know that in the 1960s, when Douglas Knowles, proposed to use the neoclassical approach to study institution, and it called that new institutional economics. And the reason was, in the turn of the 20th century in the U.S., there was a group of economists called institutionalists, and they proposed to use Marxian approach to study institution, and they called themselves institutional school. And to distinguish the application of neoclassic approach to study institution, Douglas Knowles called this approach new institutional economics. And as I follow the convention, I call this new structural economics. Okay, and this framework, the starting point is that the industrial structure in a country is endogenous to its endowment structure. And for economists, the so-called endowments is the capital, labor, natural resources. And certainly, for any country, in any given time, the availability of capital, or labor, or natural resources, its relative abundance will be different. And that difference is called the endowment structure. And here I'd like to say, endowment is a very unique economic parameters, because the total endowments for any country at any given time is the total budget of this country, total capital, total natural resources, total labor force. And this endowment also have a structure because it have relative abundance. And this relative abundance will determine the relative prices of capital or natural resources or labor force. And for economists, we know budget and relative prices are two most important parameters. And endowment, as well as its structure, determine the total budget of the country, as well as relative prices of capital, of natural resources, of labor force. And this relative abundance of the endowment will determine the competitive advantage of the economy at any given time. For a developing country, in general, they are relatively abundant in natural resources or in labor force, and they will have competitive advantages in the labor-intensive industry or resources-intensive industry. And for the high-income country, their relative abundant factors is capitals. And so they will have the competitive advantage in the capital-intensive industries. And we know that competitive advantages will determine the competitiveness of the nation. So that's the reason why the high-income country today, their competitive industries in general is in the technological intensive industry, capital intensive industries. And from this analysis, we know for a country to have the optimal industrial structure, that is means that its structure will make you the most competitive. It's determined by your competitive advantage, and the competitive advantage is determined by your endowment structure. Certainly, economic development means that we hope the low-income country one day will reach the same income level as a high-income country. And if you wanted to have the same income level as a high-income country, then you need to have the same industrial structure as a high-income country, that you need to have a very capital-intensive industry and so on. But since that the optimal industrial structure is endogenous to your endowment structure, so before you upgrade your industries, you need to upgrade your endowments. Once your endowment upgrade, your industry will upgrade. But I'd like to say, it's not only an upgrading of the industrial structure. Because when you move your industry from resources-based to a labor-intensive industry to more capital-intensive industry, you also need to improve the infrastructure, including hard infrastructure and soft infrastructure. For example, in agrarian economies, like many societies in Africa, most people live on agriculture. And they are working on a smallholder agriculture. In that kind of smallholder agriculture, economic surplus was very small. And as a farmer, each year, only a small amount of its produce, or their produce, they can exchange on the market. And in general, they sell those products in the local market and exchange with people who they know. With this kind of an economic structure, the elaborate transportation will not be needed. And because you exchange with people who you know, so you don't need to write a contract, and there's no need for an institution for contract enforcement either. But if you move up the industrial structure to the manufacturing sectors, and the manufacturing firm have a larger scale, their production is not for their own consumption. They need to sell the goods in the national market or international market. And to make this kind of production possible, then you need to improve the transportation. And also, because you are going to exchange with people who you don't know, you need to write a contract, and you also need to have a contract enforcement institution, legal institution. So we can see that the economic structure changes also means the infrastructure, both in the hard infrastructure and the soft infrastructure changes. And here I'd like to argue, follow a country's competitive advantages to develop their economic structure is the best way to promote fast and sustainable economic growth. This is because if you follow your competitive advantages, then the economy will be most competitive, will produce the most. And at some time, that means that you have the most to save. And also the investment in industry which are consistent with your competitive advantages will be most competitive, can generate the highest possible return. You have the more to save, and have the highest return to your savings. Certainly, you will save the most. And the capital endowment will increase the fastest way. And if capital endowment increase, industry will increase, will upgrade, and income can be increased. And in this process, you started from resources-intensive industry or labor-intensive industries, and gradually, according to your endowment structure, upgrading, you will upgrade your industries. And that is something like we just described, follow the flying geese pattern. And also, when a country move up to a higher latent industries, then other countries at the lower stages, they will have the competitive advantages to develop those kind of labor-intensive or resources-intensive industries. So that is the reason for the flying geese pattern in this dynamic economic structural changes. And from this understanding, if following a country's competitive advantages to develop the economy is the best way, but competitive advantages is a term only can be understood by economists. For the private sectors, their concern is profit making and how to translate the ideas of following a country's competitive advantages to develop the economy into action of the private firm. For that, we need to have a market institution. Because if we want the private sectors to follow the country's competitive advantages to choose its technology and industries, we need to have a relative price that can reflect the relative abundance of your endowment structure. If your endowment is abundant in labor force and skills in capitals, then the wage rate should be relatively low and the capital should be relatively expensive. If you have those kind of price signals, then firms for their own profitability, they will enter the labor-intensive industry to use the capital to depress labor and enter into the labor-intensive industry. And vice versa, if capital is relatively abundant and labor is relative skills, then you need to have a price signal. That is, wage should be relatively high and capital should be relatively inexpensive. And under the kind of price signals, firm for the profitability, it will choose the capital to replace the expensive level, and then there will be the capital intensive industries. And this kind of price signal can only be produced by competitive market. If the market is so important, then why we should have a government there? And this is because economic development is a process of continuous upgrading your industries. And in this upgrading, you need to improve the infrastructure also, like a transportation, telecommunication, or the legal system. And an individual firm will not be able to internalize all those changes. So you need to have a government to coordinate different private sector to make the investment in infrastructure or the legal system to improve the legal services. To coordinate those kind of changes or to provide those kind of changes by the government itself. That's one thing. And secondly, the economic development is industrial upgrading and diversification. And that kind of upgrading and diversification itself is innovation. It's risky. And so for the first mover, the possibility of failure is high. And if the first mover failed, the first mover need to bear all the cost and send the information to others who are not ready. The first mover can also be successful. And if the first mover is successful, you also send information to others. This new industry is our competitive advantages, and then you are going to have many people follow, and the competition comes, and the first mover will not be able to earn more profit than the other firm. With this kind of asymmetry between the cost of failure and a gain of success, then then people will not have the incentive to be the first mover. It's better to wait other people to demonstrate a success, then you follow. However, if there's no first movers, you cannot have a very dynamic economic growth in our country. So you need to have the government there to find a way to compensate for the first movers. And in a high-income country, we know, the government can give the first mover a pattern. However, in a developing country, it's a process of flying geese. For the low-income country, when they upgrade their industry to the new one, it's new to them, but it's mature in the world, so you cannot give them the pattern. So the government needs to find some way to compensate the first mover in order to encourage more firms willing to upgrade their industry or to diversify their industry. By that, you need to have a government to play this kind of facilitation role. And this new structural economics framework can provide understanding of the standard facts that was identified by the Growth Commission report or by the East Asia Mineral Pool. According to the new structural economics, the best way to develop the economies is to follow the country's competitive advantages. And to follow the country's competitive advantages, you need to provide the right price signal, and you also need to have a facilitating state to overcome the issue of externality and coordination. And this is exactly the standard facts number 4 and number 5 of the Growth Commission report. And if you follow your competitive advantages, certainly it will be an open economy. You produce whatever you're good at and export, and you import whatever you are not good at and import. And this is the condition number 1 of the Growth Commission report. And secondly, if you follow your competitive advantages, you will be the most competitive. So the economy is less likely to have a homegrown crisis. And when a country encounters a global crisis that we are encountering now, the country will also be in a much better position to carry out counter-cyclical fiscal monetary measure. So it will have a much better macro or macro stability. And again, that is the condition number 2 of the Growth Commission report. And if you follow your competitive advantages, as I just argued, the country will produce the most, and so have more to save. At the same time, the investment can generate the highest return, so you are going to save more and make the largest possible investment. And this is the condition number 3 of the Growth Commission report. So we can know, now we can understand this new structural economics in effect provide a consistent theoretical framework to tie all the status facts together. And this is certainly also consistent with the East Asia Miracles findings. To have a market-friendly government and to have an outward-oriented economic development policy. Okay, and in the past, as I mentioned, the economic development, no matter within a country or cross-country, follows some kind of flying geese pattern. And now we are entering in a new world. This new world is a multi-power growth world, and we are going to, instead of flying geese, we are going to have leading dragons. We know that since the Industrial Revolution up to the 2000, the world was dominated by a small number of industrialized countries, those G7 countries. Even up to 2000, the combined GDP of the 7 industrialized countries was as high as about 66%, two-thirds of the global GDP. And even measured by purchasing power parity, those 7 countries, their contribution to global GDP was still as high as about 50%. But entering into 2000, the world started to have a very noticeable changes. For example, in the 1980s, the top 5 contributors to the global growth, except for China, among those 7 countries, it was Japan, Germany, and the United Kingdom. And at that time, the U.S., its contribution to the global growth in that decade was about 26%. And China's contribution was only about 1/7 of the U.S. contribution. In the 1990s, again, the top 5 contributors, except for China, other 4 were the members of the G7 country. And the U.S., in that decade, its contribution to the global GDP was about 36%. And China's contribution was only 1/4 of the U.S. contribution. By entering into 2000 to 2009, the top 5 contributors, except for the U.S., all others are the emerging countries, including China, India, Korea, and Brazil. And China became the number one contributors. And you know, it reached about 26%. And the U.S. contribution was only about 21%. So China has about 4% higher than the U.S. contribution to the global growth. And for a developing country with a much lower income to become the new poles of global growth, then the country must have a large population. Like Brazil, its population was about 192 million in 2009. And China was 1.3 billion, India 1.1 billion, and Indonesia 227 million. And these four countries combined, their population size was 2.9 billion. So to be a new growth pole, in addition to you need to grow very dynamically, but you also need to have to be a large population in order to be a new growth pole. And this has a large implication, because if you are a large population and you grow very dynamically to have these kind of changes, and you know, your number of workers in the industrial sectors